And what we're going to talk about today is the Grand Army of the Republic. Can people hear me? Can I use this?
Yes, very soft, very soft.
I don't have a voice that carries. Let's see if this works.
Yeah.
I guess it does. So,
Buildings are here.
Oh, ooh, ooh. The marking of military events, wars, specifically in honoring veterans, is something that's kind of grown on America over the years. I've never heard of anybody commemorating Revolutionary War soldiers in any systematic way prior to the late 19th century, and even now, if you look at it, we don't usually have any events. We kind of sweep them into a general pile with all the people who have served. And even the 4th of July has tapered off as a holiday. We've more concentrated on Memorial Day and Veterans Day in recent decades. It's been an interesting progression of actually paying attention to those people who have served us. And one of the shocking things about the Civil War is that when those guys responded to the call, both South and North, the countries, if you want to consider the Confederacy a country, which Lincoln refused to do, neither side was ready to handle any of the problem that comes with putting armies in the field. There was no real provision for taking care of the wounded. They had no hospitals. They had no plans for sanitary conditions in these camps where they crowded all of the soldiers together, most of whom were farm boys who had never been exposed to anything more than chicken pox. And they had no provision for taking care of the dead. They had no cemeteries. A lot of these guys just lay in the fields forever. And they had people that went around and gathered their bones. And then you had the regional hatred so that one side wouldn't bury the bodies of the other. So whoever won the war, the opposing soldier, or battle rather, the opposing soldiers got to just rot in the fields, which is kind of nasty. And, you know, it was just generally an unorganized mess for a long time. And it was, in some instances, civilians who stepped into the void. You had the U.S. Sanitary Commission, which was all private people working. And it was eventually kind of integrated into the Northern Army's mechanisms. And they provided a lot of the nursing and other care that these soldiers needed. There was also a pension system in place, but not a very good one. And the organization we're going to talk about today, the Grand Army of the Republic, or the GAR as it is more familiarly called, was a very it was a social organization, it was a fraternal organization that styled itself after the Masons, but it was also an extremely influential lobbying group in the government. And it was responsible for many, many of the benefits that eventually came to soldiers who had served. The gentleman, let's get these guys out of the way. Canaan eventually had its own GAR chapter, and this man closest to me is James Real, and that is Bill Sackett.
Oh my gosh.
Sackett was the last veteran, Civil War veteran, in Canaan. He actually lived in Sheffield, so I don't know quite how we claim him, but he was the last member of our local chapter of the GAR. And I suspect I haven't verified this, but I suspect Jim Reel was the next to the last, and that this was taken obviously on a Memorial Day celebration. Memorial Day grew out of the Civil War. It started in the South as Decoration Day, when the women would go out and decorate the graves of their glorious fallen dead. And then it kind of migrated north and became a formal holiday that we celebrate to this day. So the history of the GAR is kind of interesting, and my interest in it was piqued by a couple of things. First, I got a box of stuff the week I opened the History Center, and in the bottom of it was a watch fob, and it had some initials on it that I always have trouble reading that scrolly stuff, but it's got some initials on it, and then it's got the date 61 to 11. So it was clearly a Civil War GAR kind of fob commemorating the 50th anniversary. It's hard to realize how close all this stuff was. I was born in 1947, and I think I was a history fiend in my bassinet, and was always extremely interested in the American West, Indians, Civil War. And my parents, bless them, they found a guy in Sheffield who had been a cowboy and who had actually fought Indians, Stone Age type of Indians with bows and arrows. And they took me up to talk to this man. I don't know how Mom knew him, but they were smart enough and sensitive enough to my interest to take me up. And so my first interview was at about age 9. And I got to talk to this guy who was a genuine American West cowboy. I never realized, however, that there were Civil War vets around. I lived out my life playing my games, and I never realized that they were veterans alive from the Civil War until the 1950s. In fact, it took the Civil War almost 100 years to be over, because the last known Civil War veteran, excuse me, Albert Olson, died at age 109 in 1956. That was 91 years after the war ended, supposedly ended. The South saw its last Confederate veteran, John Salling, die at 112 in 1958. And Walter Williams, who claimed to have been a forager in John Bell Hood's Southern forces in the last months of the war, died in 1959, supposedly aged 117. His claim is dicey, but he got laid out in a Civil War, and he was advanced to the rank of general. It was amazing. Anyway, I would have been 11 years old at the time that this man died, and I think that's pretty amazing, and I only wish that I had been able to be a few years older, know where they were, and talk to them. So here in Canaan, Sackett, as I said, was the longest live veteran, living on until 1934, and he was the last member that I know of the GAR. He kept the memory of the Union Army's valor alive long after his other comrades had died, and was in 1924 he turned over the last of the post funds to the American Legion to be used to buy a flag for the war memorial at the corner of Granite Avenue. I don't know whether the flagpole we've got there is the same one or not, but wouldn't it be a lovely continuing memorial if the GAR was the originator of that? The Civil War was a war of firsts. When John, I've already gone through this. This is the problem with writing one week and talking the next. I discussed the lack of preparation, and you know, that it was little things, like there were no dog tags. there was no identification. These guys would pin a piece of paper on their jackets before they went into war, into battle, and they would hope that somebody would be able to read that and identify them and let their families know. And there was no systematic notification, so these families wouldn't know whether anything happened unless a friend or the officer wrote to them and said, you know, I was with him when he died, or he is wounded and he is in such and such a place. It was a traumatic war, as you can imagine. It killed 2% of the American population, and most of those were young men. So you had a whole generation of women who didn't marry. They had nobody to marry. Sometimes, in their naivete at the time, a regiment might come from one town and it might be wiped out in one battle. And there goes everybody from that town that you might have considered to be a romantic partner. There was obviously a terrible cost in terms of the killed and wounded and the destruction of the Southern economy. Now, we fought the war in the South, and we fought the war, no matter how you dress it up in states' rights, we fought the war over slavery, which was the Southern way of life, very important to the economy, even though many Southerners didn't own slaves. But when the war was over, an interesting thing happened. The defeated Southern soldiers went home to a society that needed to reinvent itself, and it needed to build a romantic construct around the imagery of their past. Margaret Mitchell was probably the most successful propagandist they ever had, and that was in the 1930s that she wrote that story, and she probably did more to perpetuate the Civil War than anybody else. The South ultimately won the propaganda war, and that is because in the North, with our gritty manufacturing mentality, they wanted it over. They didn't want to think about it anymore. War had not turned out to be fun. And they wanted these guys to come home and just be absorbed into society again and not bother anybody with their mental problems, their drinking, the fact that they were wounded and had lost limbs, sometimes multiple limbs, couldn't be in that era as productive as they might have been had they been able to go and work on a farm or work in a factory or do whatever. It was pretty limiting. My mother always tells about my great-great-grandfather who were able to hire a substitute, and my grandfather was a really rock-good New Englander, and he was a Puritan work ethic, but never quit. And this guy that he hired was shot in the leg, and he spent the rest of his life sitting on the front porch of the general store, kept collecting a pension, and my grandfather was just made nuts by the thought that he had enabled such sloth. So, Grandpa wouldn't even hire anybody if they talked too much. He didn't like people who talked. He wanted people who worked. So, the Southerners come home to a nurturing society, impoverished, decimated, homes gone, but ready to embrace their veterans and to turn it into the glorious lost cause. The Northern guys march home and it's like Vietnam. There's no welcoming parades, there's no recognition, and it's just please go away and be quiet and get out of our way while we make money. So there was a lot of trouble in the North with these veterans. And I think it's significant to note that practically before the last shot was fired, they had formed in Illinois the Grand Army of the Republic. And it prospered for a few years, but it began to falter in the 1970s. Or 1870s, excuse me. In his recent book, Marching Home, Union Veterans and Their Unending War, Matthew Jordan focuses attention on the plight of these soldiers and why they needed to have an organization to advocate for them. He notes that many of the wounds, psychological and physical, never healed, and some soldiers could not fit back into the fabric of society. They drank, they caroused, they abandoned their families, they were, in short, a problem, and there was no help, no sympathy in Victorian America for this behavior. Veterans, I'm going to get a glass of water if that's okay with you folks, just to
stop
hacking at you. So there were a number of veterans organizations that formed, but GAR was by far the most successful. Jordan writes, while ex-prisoner of war associations sustained prison survivors, they had scarcely moved the hearts and minds of the northern public. If anything, ex-prisoner meetings continued to give even greater public, or to contribute to even greater public suspicion and scorn. Eventually, a reluctant nation did create, and I should say they're improved because I realize that there was a previous pension system. But even that was, thank you, even that was kind of resented by the public, which didn't believe in welfare. You may notice we're still having that discussion now as to how much support we give to people. So enter the Grand Army of the Republic, the largest veterans organization and a powerful lobbying group which formed within months of the close of the war. Immediately successful, it grew and prospered as a de facto political arm of the Republican Party. Membership was strictly limited to veterans of the late unpleasantness. Isn't that a lovely way to describe a war that killed 600,000 people? The GIR took the national stage promoting voting rights for Negro veterans. It was unusually progressive for its era, and becoming one of the first racially integrated social fraternal organizations of America. I was excited when I was reading through the local minutes for our chapter of GAR. I went down to Hartford, and they have two books of minutes that cover most of its history. Membership books and whatnot. And among the members, the charter members, was a man called Milo Free something. Now, if it was Milo Freeman, then he was the first Negro volunteer from this region and is buried out in East Canaan. I cannot read the last part of the name, so I can't tell you with any certainty that the local GAR was integrated. If it was, it was unusual in this town because we were pretty segregated. We had black community down on Sand Road and in the Lower City Cemetery, or Mountain View Cemetery as it's now known, there was a black section for burials, which I was kind of surprised to find out. But he might have been in there. He might have been. When the Republican Party's commitment to reform in the South gradually decreased, the GAR's mission became ill-defined and the organization floundered. The GAR almost disappeared in the early 1870s, and many state-centered divisions named departments and local posts ceased to exist. In the 1880s, the Union Veterans Organization revived under new leadership that advocated federal pensions for veterans. It was during the rebirth that Canaan formed their local post, January 9, 1883. So we were right in the middle of this revival. In Canaan, the David S. Cowles post number 60, so we were the 60th post in Connecticut, was officially formed in 1883, named for Colonel David S. Cowles, a Hudson, New York lawyer who was born in Canaan and who died leading his men into battle at Port Hudson, Louisiana. He was the son of the Reverend Pitkin Coles, who was an important man in our community in Asbury right down in Mountain View. The post started with four charter members, E.S. Roberts, N. Rohrbeck, L. Hedger, Milo Free, whatever it is, Adam Ridley, and Peter Mick something or other. I think it could be McCarthy, but it's not clearly written. The applications of Lucius Watrous, George Fuller, and James Reel were also sent to the committee for approval. Like the national organization, the Powell's Post reached its largest enrollment in the 1890s, when it was not uncommon to have 20 or more veterans at meetings, which were called encampments. PAR reached its largest enrollment in 1890 with 490,000 members. It held an annual encampment every year from 1866 to 1949. And you will read books that say that these national encampments showed that the war was over and that there was great camaraderie between the former enemies. And they have those pictures of the old guys shaking their hands over pickets on the wall at the top of Pickett's Charge. And all looks very good on tape. Rudy's lie. And if you read the history, you'll find out that they had a lot of fistfights between these septuagenarians, and that one guy was actually killed in the last casualty of Gettysburg. It's kind of fascinating to look at the pictures of these guys. Ken Burns used a lot of the footage from these reunions, and it's quite JFK. I love it. So I found no reference to Kahneman attending big encampments, such as the 50th anniversary of Gettysburg in 1913. But they did travel throughout Connecticut for local reunions, and at least one county reunion was held here in Canaan. And I have a picture here. This has got a somewhat questionable provenance. There's two problems. First, one source says it was New Canaan, and in 1880, we didn't form until 1883. But I know we had at least one encampment here, and I'm sure there were veterans who were moving around. Our post was formed for men from nearby Massachusetts, Norfolk, Falls Village, and whatnot. So there may have been men, and a lot of men transferred in to this post. So there may very well have been an encampment here that was geographically convenient in 1880, and there may have been Canaan men that were already members of other posts. Lakeville also had a post, and they were very active, and there was a lot of communication. This was a very social organization there. They eat together, have meetings, go to events, commemorations, etc., etc. In the early years, when the men were in their 40s and 50s, meetings were held at night, first in the Armory Building, probably the Town Hall. I'm guessing that that's the Armory Building because in World War I, they held their training sessions in the Town Hall, and they stored their weapons there. So I'm guessing that that's what they're referring to when they say the Armory Building. And later in the public rooms of the Warner Hotel, a space they rented for $25 a year. As they aged and retired, meetings were moved to Wednesday afternoons, and increasingly they opted to cancel meetings during the heat of summer or in February or March. As time went by, the inevitable happened. Membership waned through death, disease, and disinterest. Minutes regularly record the sickness and demise of members, and by 1918, James Reel was grumbling that if members weren't going to attend meetings, they might as well disband. It did not disband, but attendance limped along with six or seven at meetings until into the 1920s. By 1918, when the men were in their 70s, death notices were increasingly in their minutes and funds were decreasing. A committee was assigned to talk to the Masons about the group's rent, as they no longer had enough funds to cover their expenses. The Masons, who had just built the building on the corner, kindly waived the fee for in perpetuity. The GAR was very grateful for that. Even as their funds diminished, however, they continued their charitable efforts, sometimes sending funds to widows of destitute veterans to help them with burial expenses, often sending memorial wreaths or even gravestones. In 1913, the Post voted to loan Comrade Fields $25 to tide him over when he lost his pension payment. I wonder what he could have done with his pension payment. But he promised to pay it back, and in theory did. They were very tight with their money, and if you didn't pay your dues, you were suspended. There was a lot of suspension votes in the minutes of men who were not paying their dues. And the dues, the annual dues, were a dollar paid quarterly. So you can see the financial strait that some of these guys were in, where a quarter was not something they were parting with very easily. Clearly the group had a social quality, but in 1919 it was discovered that the group's dishes had been stolen. And they didn't replace them. So it was obviously getting hard to have the meals together that they had enjoyed earlier. It was later voted to give William Sackett the group's cupboard. So he got that. I wonder where it went. Locally, attention focused on the annual Memorial Day celebration. This was a serious affair for them, and they started planning months ahead for their annual Memorial Day events. In his General Order number 11, dated May 5, 1868, the first GAR Commander-in-Chief, John Logan, declared May 30th to be Memorial Day, also referred to for many years as Decoration Day, calling upon the GAR membership to make the May 30th observance an annual occurrence. Locally, planning began months in advance, and the men usually accepted an invitation from one of the local churches to attend a memorial service en masse. They would gather, as veterans do today, at Lower Cemetery at 7 a.m. to honor the Civil War dead buried there, and then continue to Ashley Falls, Canaan Valley, East Canaan, and sometimes even Norfolk, before having a communal dinner. A speaker was usually engaged, and they paid for the speaker, which is kind of unusual, I think, in that day and age. The GAR was organized into departments at the state level and posts at the community level, and the military-style uniforms were worn by its members. There were advertisements in GAR records donated to the History Center announcing that where one can buy uniforms, badges, hats, and the like. There are also sources for gravestones, an item increasingly in demand as the decades passed. We have some of those items here. The records that I have were donated to the center by Dave Bailey, who some of you have met over the past couple of years. Hiram Eddy was the chaplain of the group for a while, and these records, that family are pack rats, and they have everything.
Wow.
So he dug out all the GAR records and gave them to the History Center this past fall, and it's been pretty interesting to look at them. It was very military in its structure, and you had to be accepted by a committee, voted in, you had to fill out an application form that detailed all of your medical history, which is kind of interesting. I discovered that five members of this group had some kind of physical debility that was related directly to the war. Two of them were amputees from mini-ball wounds. And some of the others had those more amorphous diseases that afflicted people for decades after the war, dysentery and nervous disorders and whatnot. And they were all meticulously marked down. So in this group, I'm guessing, I haven't actually done a tally of the membership, but I'm guessing they may have had 50 members, 20 of whom were really active. You have five who were war casualties. And although there was a pension of $25 a month after 1890, that wasn't very much if you couldn't work because of your disease. My husband's great-great-grandfather was wounded at Petersburg, and he was in the artillery, I'm guessing, at the injury, but it was called a rupture of the back. And I suspect that there was a shell that burst near them, and he was thrown, and his back was damaged when he hit something. he was a house painter, and he couldn't paint houses with this ruptured disc in his back. So they existed on $25 a month, and it was not a pretty picture for them. As the men aged, and as they were less able to hire people to take care of their quarters, they began to consider the possibility that they would allow women to form an association with them. They had considered a women's relief corps. And one was finally formed in Canaan around 1900, but its history kind of reflects the Canaan Fire Department when it considered a woman's auxiliary and refused to do it the first time around. And they voted. It wasn't a bad vote, it was 5-4, not to let women anywhere near their male sanctum. By 1900, though, these guys are getting old. They're up in their 80s, and it's okay if the women clean the room and cook the meals and take care of them. Then I think it's not clear at the end. The minutes kind of taper off, and the last document I have is Sackett giving me the money, $64, to buy the flagpole. And I think that was 1924. So this picture of James Real and Sackett is subsequent to that, I believe. You notice that Sackett... You notice that Sackett is all decked out with all of his medals. It looks like Real has gotten a hat. So there they are, proud old warriors. I was pretty fascinated to go through and see how many men from this region had marched off to war and how many were subsequently in this veterans organization. As it died out, of course, we had already had a world war, and we were working on another world war. So the American Legion became our repository of military history, and subsequently the veterans of foreign wars. So we have a kind of a living legacy here in Canaan of honoring veterans. So that's about all I know about.
Kathy, what was the money
at 24. And that's when he had money for the pole. So I wonder, I would love to know, and I don't have any records in my possession of whether that's the original pole or whether it's been replaced.
And we all wouldn't have had that.
VFW might know. They, I've got to see if I can get any of their records. I really ought to have more about them too. Proud old men.
I think there was Sackett, as I know, he's from Sheffield, right?
Right.
And I think that they came, they started, some of them started to live in Canaan. Lonnie Sackett.
Yeah.
Rose Sackett was in my class.
Right, right.
When I did a story on him a long time ago, because I was still with the Lakeville Journal, I thought, I gotta find out, you know, about this guy, and usually you can pretty easily. That was before Ancestry.com. And I called the family, and they had no idea, absolutely no idea that he served, so that wasn't too productive.
Yeah.
I should put together, in fact, now I have, I went down to the state library, and the fastest way to get the data was to take pictures of each page. So I'm kind of tediously processing those pages and printing them out so they're accessible in a loose leaf notebook. But I kind of want to go through, see what their membership was, and there will be people coming and going over time. Of course, so I'll have to, you know, count carefully, but I'd like to actually do little biographies of these guys who served as much as I can, and that's pretty plausible to do these days. And then we would have a pretty good record of what Civil War involvement we had. Anybody else got any questions about this embryonic veterans group?
Kathy, wasn't there some pictures of parades with them in it?
I can't find the darn thing. I've been looking for 2 weeks.
I thought I remember one.
Yeah, it was Norfolk with the Canaan Band in front. Mm-hmm. And I put in every search word that I can think of, and my computer is saying, no, I don't have it. But I know it does.
So summer.
I've got to find that, and I've processed all this material into three loose leaf notebooks so far, and we'll add the minutes once I've got them organized and sequential. And this material is also in those notebooks, so I'm trying to put together as comprehensive a record as I got of this group, which is largely forgotten.
I'm not sure, but somewhere I recently read about some woman that was still getting the pension of her husband, and she was 16 when she married him at 90. He was 90.
Yeah.
And, somehow, I mean, I'm sure she's passed away now. But.
Yeah.
I think there's still one Sackett living, and I think it's one of the daughters.
Yeah.
His name was Trelawney, and they lived, you know, where Allen Dale comes down on the river. Go right across, and it was a, I can still picture a greenhouse on the right hand side with a slew of kids.
Yeah, and she still lives there. She lives next door. She built a little green house.
It might be good to talk to her.
Yeah, it would be interesting. Yeah. I wonder if she, do you have any idea what relationship she might have to this fellow?
She was a daughter of Trelawney.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know who she's, you know who she's married to now? Or?
Well, she's widowed, and I can't think of her name now, but she was very active in the Methodist Church. She was a lay preacher.
We could find her last name, maybe we could.
Well, Bill Sackett, this is
Billy was one of the kids.
Bill Sackett?
Yeah.
Because Evelyn's married, was married to Bill Sackett.
Who was?
Evelyn.
Evelyn?
Sackett. I don't know her main name, but she is a caregiver. She worked for Phyllis Christian and Mavis Cross.
Maybe she would
know. We see her every Wednesday night when we go to the Veterans Center.
You still see
Evelyn?
Yeah. Huh. Maybe you could ask her?
What's the question?
I think that, but the last name is of the daughter of Trelawney Sackett.
Okay. But you did try to get some information from
Trelawney. Oh, a very long time ago.
Yeah.
And they didn't even know.
I saw her about a month ago in the store.
Yeah. Well, if you run into her again, grab her and say, do you know anything about the Civil War history of, of these guys?
Who knows? You may even have something.
Yeah, that would be fabulous, wouldn't it? There were two Sacketts in the GAR post here. One was TJ and one was William. And Bill was the one that lasted the longest. And he's buried up in Sheffield. He was living in Sheffield at the time of his death. But, you know, the state boundaries almost didn't seem to matter with these groups because, you know, regiments formed from almost everywhere. And if you were somewhere within 30 miles, you might very well go and join that group, particularly if you had a friend who was going to go and join that group.
Yeah.
So you have people here in this corner of the state who join New York regiments and Massachusetts regiments, and you have Massachusetts people coming down here. So we have Milo Freeman as our first volunteer, even though he too lived in Sheffield. And it's quite an interesting, that's why I don't confine my history center to Connecticut or Canaan. There's just too much traffic back and forth among the towns.